Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Henry Louis Gates Jr., and I have the pleasure of being the director of the Hutchins Center for African and African-American Research at Harvard University. And it's my honor to welcome you to the fourth in our virtual W.E.B. Du Bois lecture series. And now to host this afternoon's events, I would like to introduce Abby Wolf, the Executive Director of the Hutchins Center.
Hello, thank you, Skip. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to welcome you here today to this virtual space for Daphne Brooks' lecture, which is the first of two lectures this week. So we know that after today, you'll want to come back for more on Thursday. One housekeeping item, please write your questions in the Q&A tab at the bottom of your screen. We ask that you keep them brief as we anticipate there will be many and we'd like to get through as many as we can. I'll note that questions may be edited for clarity and length during the Q&A, and I have the honor of reading those questions to Professor Brooks. Now it's my pleasure to say a few words about Glenda R. Carpio, who will introduce Professor Brooks's lecture this afternoon. Glenda Carpio is professor of African and African American Studies and English at Harvard University. She's also the director of undergraduate studies in AAAS. She's the author of Laughing Fit to Kill, Black Humor in the Fictions of Slavery, and the co-editor with Werner Solers of African American Literary Studies, New Texts, New Approaches, New Challenges. Professor Carpio started her teaching career in Compton, California, where she taught eighth grade English and fourth grade through the Teach for America program. She is a perennial favorite of students at Harvard, where she received the Abramson Award for Excellence and Sensitivity in Undergraduate Teaching, and also has served as faculty advisor to Fuerza Latina, a student group that promotes Latin American cultures at Harvard. Professor Carpio received her PhD in English from the University of California at Berkeley and earned her BA at Vassar College and has been a member of Harvard's faculty since 2009 and has always been a very good friend to the Hutchins Center. Please join me in welcoming Professor Glenda Carpio this afternoon.
Thank you, Abby. That was such a warm welcome. It's my pleasure to be here to introduce somebody I fondly call my darling D. And I was thinking about you, Daphne, about a month ago. I discovered that, I think about you often, but I discovered that David Bowie did a cover of Wild is the Wind, and it's beautiful. And then I went and looked it up, and it turns out that it was an homage to Nina Simone, right? He was so moved by Nina Simone's performance of that he covered the song. And I thought, wow, the one person in the world who would definitely have lots to say about that, it's my darling Dee. And so it's with great pleasure that I welcome you, Daphne. Everybody probably knows this, but I'll read out some of your bio for those who don't. Daphne Brooks is William R. Kennan, Jr. Professor of African American Studies, American Studies, Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies, and Music at Yale University. She's the author of two books, Bodies in Descent, Spectacular Performances of Race and Freedom, 1850 to 1910, winner of the Arrow Hill Award for Outstanding Scholarship on African-American Performance from ASTR, and Jeff Buckley's Grace. That's her second book, or her first book, rather. Brooks is currently working on a three-volume study of Black women in popular music culture entitled Subaltern Blues, Black Women, Sound Modernity, in the first volume of which of the trilogy, Liner Notes for the Revolution, The Intellectual Life of Black Feminist Sound, is due to be published by Harvard University Press in February of 2021. Brooks has authored numerous articles on race, gender, and performance in popular music, such as the wonderful essay I had the privilege to edit, Sister, Can You Line It Out? Sora Neale Hurston's In the Sound of Angular Black Womanhood. She's also another wonderful essay is Puzzling the Intervals, Blind Tom in the Poetics of Sonic Slate Narrative, and Nina Simone's Triple Play. It's another great essay. Today, I think, you know, we'll be able to really enjoy a live performance of some of this wonderful work that she's been gathering for her book to be out so soon. So excited for that. Welcome, Daphne.
Glenda Carpio, that is the best introduction anyone could ever get. You mentioned Nina Simone and David Bowie. Are you kidding me? We could talk about it for days. Thank you for the lovely introduction. Thank you for being such a generous interlocutor. I look to you for all sorts of expansive ideas about subversiveness in our Black comedic cultures and beyond that. We do need to talk about Chris Rock and some problems with what he said about the civil rights movement. So that is like a sidebar. Yes. So it's my great thanks to all of you for taking time to gather virtually, which takes up so much of our time right now. I sincerely hope that everyone is taking very good care of mind, body, and spirit in these unfathomable times. And go ahead and share this PowerPoint so that folks can be with me in this way. I also want to take a moment to extend my sincere thanks and greetings to so many of my marvelous colleagues and dear friends in the African American Studies community and ally units at Harvard, interlocutors, former students who are blazing brilliant trails in the field. Hello out there. And I wanted to also acknowledge the Zoom presence of my regal and majestic 94-year-old mother, Juanita Brooks, who resides in Menlo Park, California, right next door to Stanford University, where I grew up. Hi, Mom. And I believe as well, my equally extraordinary 91-year-old father-in-law, Dr. Jerry Jacobson, out in Boulder, Colorado. I believe he may be on the call today as well. So thank you both for being inspirations to me and to us all. The nonagenarians are doing it, people. Let me also take a moment to thank my fierce and fearless editor, Sharmila Sen, who's been a force and a great source of support to me in finishing my forthcoming book. And finally, I want to thank you, thank the faculty and staff at the Hutchins Center for staying the course when we shifted to our online world and overseeing arrangements for my talks this week. I especially want to thank Skip Gates for his ongoing generosity and support of my work dating back to when I was a small child at the Du Bois Institute in the late 90s. Special thank you to Matt Weinberg for his kind and steady assistance through all of these months of planning. So the talk that I'm giving today is part of a project that started as the end of a long gestating book that's now due, as Professor Carpio was just saying a moment ago, this coming February, Liner Notes for the Revolution, The Intellectual Life of Black Feminist Sounds. That manuscript kept growing and growing and growing. And so it ultimately made sense to surgically remove the ending, to free it, so to speak, and let it live independently. And so this week I'm sharing with you work from that newly freed work project, a Black feminist cultural and historical rereading of the legendary and in Black studies circles infamous so-called 1935 folk opera, Porgy and Bess. This is a standalone book project that traces the history of Black women culture workers, the actors, the musicians, the composers, novelists, playwrights, cultural critics, and their relationship to the production. And it also pays close attention to the intersectional politics informing the prehistory of the show, as well as the long tail afterlives of this work that are still very much with us today. So today's material is largely taken from the very beginning of this project, though the coda includes some work that appears in the Liner Notes book. And I should say as well that the roots of this research can be traced directly back to my time spent in residence a decade ago at the Radcliffe Institute, at which time, the deeply provocative Diane Paulus, Suzanne Laurie Parks reimagining of Porgy and Bess at the ART, which also included the innovative work of musical adapter Deidre L. Murray and starring Audra McDonald and Norm Lewis, was staged that year. I had the pleasure of seeing the show multiple times in Cambridge and then on Broadway, and much of my initial thinking about this project emerged as a result of that production. So I'm grateful to return virtually to this community after traveling for so many years through this book's evolution. One final caveat, the running time for this talk is about 60 minutes. I always like to give signposts when we reach the discussion of a pivotal blues record, the pivotal blues record, you'll know we're approaching the finish line. In the interval between a wily and resourceful Southern dame's resolve to spin sonic gold out of the sorrow songs of the South Carolina dispossessed and the bomb-throwing tactics of a demure vaudevillian lass cutting loose at the microphone, there is orchestrated silence. We are 2 years away from the rage and devastation, the rolling massacre of Black life that would spread from city to city, from Charleston to New London, from Macon to Philadelphia, from Chicago to Texarkana, from New York to Elaine, at least 36 cities, one rural, and one rural area, and on across the nation. But the people in the streets know that the manipulation of sound, pumping up the volume of agony and grief, deep, forceful, soul-stirring dignity, and decades upon decades of disappointment, precisely by way of altogether shutting down the sound of their injury, is a fundamentally radical tactic, a wholly disruptive means to altering the ways in which white folks sensorially experience their fantastic notions of Blackness as calamitous and excessive, clunky and vulgar, innocuous and mellifluous, but above all else, hourly spectacular, present and strange. They walked the gilded streets of Fifth Avenue and 57th, the site where Trump Tower now sits, striding without speech or song, but with signage and absolute focused grace and powder keg potent resolve, while a reported 10,000 or more look on, upright backs, hands clasped, everything in steady motion, nothing but a solemn drum line to direct their path. It is a performance of the sovereignty of Blackness, not the quiet of which Kevin Quashie speaks in his lush and contemplative study on that subject, but as silence goes, and as he suggests, it is an articulation of withholding and stillness, a hailing of onlookers to bear witness to the scale of disregarded, catastrophic Black suffering. Some carry the messages that sum up the bare essence of their life or death grievances. They lay everything on the line in crisp text aimed at rejecting the chronic insult hurled upon their lot. Declarations of intent that manifest the moral economy of their struggle, messages that indict the perpetuity of domestic terror wreaking havoc on their lives. And the brutality of a public sphere with no 14th Amendment anywhere in sight. Some make the pointed call to pray for the Lady Macbeths of East St. Louis, a particular reminder of what Black women endure in the harrowing face of progressive era racial slaughter. It is a sign that captures the weariness of a violence produced not by sheet-wearing thugs in the night, but by white women with a taste for venom and an especially pronounced hatefulness towards the sisters on the streetcar, the ones that they drag out of their seats, out into the street where they strip them of their shoes and beat them in broad daylight. Some hold banners of this very image, deemed criminal by the NYPD, censored and snatched away from the marchers before it can circulate. And it drives home the truth of this wilderness where there is no mercy to be found, as historian Sarah Haley has so stirringly made clear. On her knees before the president with children clinging to her and looking on, she is a supplicant for the masses, pleading the case for her beloved to an unmoved soul. It is an image of maternal despair that conjures that which is forever familiar to those of us who know the long history of Black resistance, but especially that which unfolded in the postbellum era, in the age of too many red summers to count, when Black women, as Ms. Ida B. Wells told us all those years ago, stood on the front lines of a twinned battle to blow up the white patriarchal grassroots terror complex that cranked out propaganda about the gross libidinal threat of Black men and women, and then use the falsities to execute the former en masse, sexually control and violate the latter, and gut the socioeconomic infrastructure of a people searching for ways to reconstruct itself. What is the corrective for the randomness and ubiquity of this evil? What kind of protest cuts through the din of this brutality? Let Dame Morrison tell the tale of this march, the second of its kind, to recognize that the negation of sound might yield dramatic, if nonetheless fleeting, forms of public legibility that might in turn sway the white masses to give a damn about the matter of Black life, and might likewise signal a new public-facing vocabulary for the expression of Black grief and outrage. What was possible to say was already in print on a banner that repeated a couple of phrases from the Declaration of Independence and waved over the head of its bearer. But what was meant came from the drums. It was July in 1917, and the beautiful faces were cold and quiet, moving slowly into the space the drums were building for them. And quote unquote, of course, this is all Morrison. Now down Fifth Avenue from curb to curb came a tide of cold Black faces, speechless and unblinking because what they meant to say but did not trust themselves to say, the drums said for them. And what they had seen with their own eyes and through the eyes of others, the drums described to a T. Unspeakable things, as our forever genius Morrison would say, the kind that takes shape in the silence, spoken through the language of the percussive line, through spare yet prodigious instrumental direction and orchestration. It is an event that would foreshadow others to come as the century would unfold, as cultural critic Sarah Marcus reveals in her forthcoming book on political disappointment. And it is one that I'm lingering on here at the top of my remarks today because it so powerfully represents a crucial shift in why and how Black sound was so significant as a terrain of struggle and cultural insurgency in the years immediately before and after the endless Red Summer of 1919. I start here then with 1917, with images, some of which I should add come courtesy of the Beinecke Library's James Weldon Johnson collection here at Yale, in order to first call attention to the radical silence deployed by Black folks as a call to arms in the wake of that year's overwhelming white supremacist violence in East St. Louis and elsewhere. But my point here is actually to move us a bit backwards to the dawn of the 20th century, when that resourceful Southern dame to whom I referred earlier took a chance on using Black sound without Black bodies for her own economic survival. That choice of hers, as I hope to show, had just as much to do with the kind of furious white grievances and melancholia that fueled the riot in her hometown of Charleston in May of 1919 as it did with putting food on the table in her widowed household. But it is also, as I intend to suggest today, created the conditions for a Black sonic backlash that forever altered the course of popular music culture, that of the recorded blues revolution, led by sisters who gave unprecedented mass culture voice to the affective complexities of those other sisters, all dressed in white and walking to the sound of their own beat. White Widow, Charleston Burning, and a blues Black feminist experiment on the horizon in 1920 are thus linked together in my mind as a concentrated decade-long struggle over Black social and cultural sovereignty. And it's the silent march that we might think of as the break in this maelstrom, an historical interval, as Marcus might put it, the mediated temporal space between modernity's early 20th century anti-Black sound and a Black feminist sonic riot on record, the heretofore rarely acknowledged cultural rejoinder to a Red Summer catastrophe and its equally repressive Jim Crow aftermath. To get to that moment, though, I'm suggesting that we have to look back first to the women who were interested in inhabiting Black women's sounds and think about their cultural connections to the violence that explodes in 1919. This is the Blackface broken record of which I intend to speak, manifested in the figure of one Janie Screven Dubose Hayward. The entanglements between her sound and the affective conditions of white grievance in Charleston writ large have, it would seem, everything to do with both 1919 and the Black feminist blues rebellion that came right on its heels.
There's always a little musical pun in my work, so it's just a little snippet of Sly Stone Family Affair. So when Janie Screven DuBose Hayward walked into a Victor Talking Machine Company recording studio in 1923, her hustle was already more than a decade strong. She'd been huffing it as a South Carolinian widow since 1888 and scraping together ways to support her grade school children, one daughter and one often sickly son who stuck close to her, absorbing her life choices with a fascination that would become manifest in his own adulthood. For the once wealthy and now destitute white citizens of Charleston, South Carolina, who were living in the long shadow of the War of Northern Aggression, decisions had to be made about how to survive in a city made prosperous by a massive slave economy and now crumbling under the weight of its own de rigueur, anti-Black systems of hierarchy, crushingly exploitative hiring practices, grossly unequal housing and educational resources, widespread tolerance of racial terror, the usual combo platter of conditions plaguing the post-Reconstruction era South. But Charleston, that commercial metropolis that once ruled the roost of Atlantic slave trade, commerce, and corruption, was its own particular fallen world of contradictions, devastated by the boll weevil and yet eerily grand in its still standing colonial architecture, controlled by white lapsed aristocrats and yet demographically dominated by Black folk, people of African descent whose distinct gullah customs were a thing of obstinate beauty in the face of centuries of captivity and human commodification. The specificity and insularity of language and tales, the food and music passed around and preserved on the local sea islands by those people whom Curtis Mayfield might lyrically refer to as darker than blue, were vernacular phenomena in Charleston, where racial lines of division were frequently and casually transgressed by white city dwellers. They were the ones, we might think, who proved Zora Neale Hurston's ethnographic theory regarding the absence of the concept of privacy for Black people. Janie Screven DuBose Hayward was one of those many low country raconteurs who never comprehended that concept, instead turning what one unreconstructed historian explains away as her grief-induced fascination with the gullahs, her discovery of their exotic subculture, into a lucrative form of employment and one that transformed her into a local celebrity who both capitalized on and helped to drive the burgeoning Charleston tourist industry at the turn of the century. There were gullah songbooks and lyric pamphlets to be published, lectures on the supposed ways of this Negro ethnic group to be given, and poems, sketches, and songs to be composed as odes to what Hayward saw in these people, this alien race who were an obvious and convenient synecdoche for her nostalgic longings and intimate desires. This she sought to document in her career as a dialect performer and successful local author as the 1910s rolled on, and in her 1912 pamphlet, also courtesy of the Beinecke, Songs of the Charleston Darkie, in which she aimed to render in print the romance of her anti-Black imagination. The shrimp seller, the vegetable merchant, the washerwoman, the baker, Hayward saved the usual kind of perversely affectionate place for each of these local color domesticated archetypes in her thin little booklet, 29 pages slim, but chocked full of the kind of familiar caricature that dominated the New South fervor ad nauseum in those long ago, yet oh so close decades of cross-regional reconciliation and revisionist history. The darkie here, as it is in the works of Joel Chandler Harris, Thomas Nelson Page, and all the other writers slinging white supremacist folktale fantasies of that particular period, is the familiar repository of pleasure and ease, the plantation good life and all its essentially rendered culinary delight, hawking groundnut cake and fresh-caught seafood with nary a care in the world, reminding readers of Charleston's resilience that seemingly rested on the promise of Black docility restored. Sing along with her, these souvenir booklets suggest, and participate in these vocal correctives to a past, quote unquote, reign of unjust judge and jury over a city that she insists is once more on the rise, looking back without self-pity, looking forward unafraid. Janie's particular fascination with her various mama characters, by turns wrinkled and old, weary and yet devoted to her little white charges, are the ones whom she enlivens with stock resentment towards those damned Yankees and regret for having been set free from the shelter of old Massa's care. They are testament to the ways that Black women were for her the host bodies, the effigies of archival memory, as well as the scaffolding by which she might make herself anew, transformed from a Margaret Mitchell tragic heroine into a star of modern Charleston entertainment and an aspiring recording artist. By her death in 1939, as South Shall Ride Again, DuBose Hayward biographer Robert Hutchinson points out, she was known as one of the most famous dialect recitalists of the 20th century. Janie's capitalization and on and mobilization of aural stereotypes encapsulates what Jennifer Stover reads as those manifestations of caricature without correlating visual signifiers and often standing in for them. This form of colonizing preservation tactics through sound encourages what Stover refers to as the listening ear, that which, quote unquote, works by attempting to suppress and reduce an individual's myriad fine-grained embodied listening experiences by shunting them into narrow, conditioned, and correct responses that are politically, culturally, economically, legally, and socially advantageous to whites. In other words, performance repertoires like that of Hayward's attuned listening publics to hear the Black womanhood of her own addled dreams on frequencies controlled by her. Like the Tambo and Bones troupes that ran rampant across the previous century on the minstrel stage, she made sounds that primed dominant audiences to listen out for her curated construction of gendered Blackness, but importantly, she did it without the burnt cork. Her ambitions in the early 20th century mark the advent of a moment in which white folks, and particularly white women, began to translate their longing for and anxiety towards Blackness into other expressive and popular forms and technological realms, the culmination of which resulted in a still under-theorized white women's Blackface recording culture. It would take, and my apologies for the DIY photograph of this printout here, it would take some 10 years between the release of her songbook pamphlet and her attempts to try to make it into the recording studio, but Hayward's long game was one in which she marketed her quote unquote spellbinding and most entertaining readings of her original poems and sketches of the Carolina Coast Negro, as this 1922 Charleston Evening Post clipping describes it, took her act on the road, according to this article, and aimed to land a spring 1923 slot on Victor's label making Victrola Records to reach an even wider audience jonesing for that old time sound. If there are said recordings, they are ones that I have yet to find in my digging. But her aspiration is perhaps just as interesting because of the way that it calls attention to a strain of cultural performances that encapsulate the white supremacist backdrop for the crisis that was and still remains 1919. To be sure, Hayward's story of Blackface livelihood is one that is as old as the hills. And yet it is a tale still rarely acknowledged for what it directly begat in American popular culture. And it is for me a provocative gateway to thinking about the history of how and why white women's racial performances surprisingly and yet centrally relate to the development of particular kinds of Black sonic womanhood in the early 20th century that still deeply aesthetically, formalistically, and ideologically inform modernity's cultural imaginary and have likewise sparked some of the boldest and most innovative riposte issued by Black women musicians. Hers is a repertoire that haunts as it establishes the terms by which a familial Blackface pedagogy that her aforementioned son, the novelist turned playwright turned librettist, DuBose Hayward, would excel in and export globally in the 1920s and 30s and in the form of America's favorite opera, as the New York City Metropolitan Opera advertised as such a year ago in September of 2019. Janie Screven DuBose Hayward's seemingly run-of-the-mill 1912 minstrel souvenir songbook is then, I want to suggest, the broken record in our pop memory, the once popular and oft-played yet now discarded thing in the dustbin of culture. It's the kind of cultural object whose worth can be measured by the resonances it left behind, the networks of appropriation, mimicry, and replication that in this case ultimately opened up a new chapter in the battlefield for what we might think of figuratively as the very soul of sonic Black womanhood. And as we shall see, it was a war that was underway long before the sisters themselves even gained entrance into the fight room. But when they did, as I argue, on the other side of 1919, they thickened the terms of their own sonic ontology by calling attention to the problem of the archive that frames their very existence, fuels their aesthetic fortitude, and has fundamentally revolutionized sonic culture for some 100 years now. She was not alone in getting her act together. As historian Mickey McKalia has shown, white women's performances of Blackness and plantation nostalgia writ large were a virtual cottage industry in the 1890s and 1910s, often organized, sponsored, and promoted by the many varied lost cause apologist ladies social clubs and parlor circles that called to order and held court in places as varied as Kentucky, Georgia, Nashville, Tennessee, Chicago, Illinois, New York City. Southern female dialect recitals, as some referred to them, were key localized flashpoints in an epoch of nation. These populous and often increased problematic spectacles on the vaudeville stage and recording industry, where white men as well as women, the so-called coon shatters, cut blues recording before African Americans gained access to the pop world game. These sorts of adjacencies between burnt cork theater cabaret, as we popular visual composition, notional presence of music, and absolute dominance of white blues century, to say nothing about the birth of D.W. Griffith's cinematic attack, are relevant, it should be noted, in as much as their cumulative currency with the fundamental cross-media ubiquity of white supremacist ideas about Black identity formations permeating multiple and intersecting dimensions of the nascent modern culture industry. As many have noted, it was a phenomenon that long after the days of T.D. Rice and Stephen Foster effectively structured and policed the mass, sensorial, and affective experience of Blackness as embodied performance on the stage and on screen, as material artifact, decorative object, and leisure item in the home, as foreign, taboo, rhythmic transaction to be enjoyed through one's own music making, and the sheer delight of listening to and looking at difference made manifest in new technologies. White women in the North, as well as the South, like Hayward, were everywhere in the mix of this long postbellum, gilded age turned progressive era moment, finding their public voices. There's T.D. Rice. Here we go. Yes. Finding their public voices through racial performances steeped in gauzy, nostalgic, white supremacist remembrances of the way we never were. McKalia has provocatively shown how, for instance, those women of the Arch Club in Chicago were busy in 1901 gathering together under the spell of Jeanette Robinson Murphy, a white Southern professional reader entertainer who specialized in Black dialect, guided the club women in the rituals of tying bandanas around their heads and shoulders in the style of an old mammy and rubbing the left hind foot of a Southern graveyard rabbit for good luck. Murphy coaxed them into joining her in singing a Negro lullaby, which McKalia recounts by way of the Chicago Tribune's coverage. Quote unquote, "First, Mrs. Murphy had the audience repeat the word. Then she gave them the tune. Then she told them to put their tongues close behind the upper teeth and not let go of their ends until they reached the next one. She suggested they clap their hands and stamp with one foot in syncopated time." To the left of the stage where Murphy stood, adds McKalia, was a concession operated by an unnamed Black woman identified in the Tribune only as the original Aunt Jemima. Crucially too, as she reminds, there was nothing uncommon about this scene, as this was the era when white women around the country got their rocks off, performing and participating in events large and small that featured professional and amateur impersonators of captive Black women. It was an industry that allowed for them, from the stage to the living room, and whether for putative historical presentation or shared amusement, to raise funds for favorite causes or for pay. They were out there. And as my colleague, the independent blues historian and intrepid archivist Elijah Wald has shared with me, we find evidence of these women entertainers performing and engaging in varying modes of rehearsing their acts dating back to at least the 1890s, when the Illustrated American published a letter from a reader extolling the virtues of a woman who, quote unquote, lectured on the folklore and songs of the Negroes in Southern states, and who persuaded one friend to play Negro melodies on the banjo while another sang Negro songs. She made $200 from the reading, end quote. The enterprising Edna Thomas, described in the publication Social Progress in 1924 as a young Southern white woman who was carrying Negro spirituals around the world, was yet another kind of artist who leaned into her alleged proximity to Mammy Bonafides, going so far as to detail her sly methods of coerced collecting. Quote, "I have gathered melodies," says Thomas. "My old mammy objects very much to my putting her music down on paper, and she has a fine contempt for what are called jubilee songs. It has required some skill to extract any of them from the consciousness of their possessors," end quote. Hayward, seemingly some years before Thomas's transatlantic stardom, saw fit to jump into the fray. She was special, and not just because of the fact that she allegedly may have made it into the studio at the behest of Victor, a feat accomplished by few of her fellow female dialect impersonators, a distinct sort of artist from that of pure vocalist. Her closest peer would have been someone like C.L. Turner, who we see here, another artist brought to my attention by Wald as we both went searching this past year for archival traces of these artists. The Virginia-born Turner is worth noting, since she kept her career alive for such a long stretch, beginning in the 20s and lasting through the 70s, performing what she dubbed as the folk music of African-Americans that she'd learned as a child. Turner cut her first album, Seal Sings, and later retitled Songs of the American South, on, I kid you not, Colonial Records, circa 1947. And a collection of her work, Makin' Glory, is available for listening on YouTube, a bit of which is worth hearing now in order to get a sense of the phonic aesthetics, the timbre, the pitch, phrasing, the delivery of the dialect recording artist.
This is a traditional intoned prayer as done by an old-fashioned Negro preacher.
You need to adjust the
intoning
volume.
Is a rhythmical syncopation of speech practiced in the good old days and seldom heard today. This prayer usually sets the stage for the sermon. O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, with a stumbling knee we bow before Thee. Lord, open the window of heaven, turn a listening ear down, and I hear Thy humble servant's prayer. Lord, come a-riding, come a-riding, mount your gospel steed, and come a-riding into this low ground of the sorrow.
A phenomenon from a different era. Some folks did. Janie Hayward, however, was special, not only because of the year, 1923, in which she sidled up to the microphone and set her routine down for the record. This was the same year in which Empress Bessie made her debut track for Columbia, establishing just to have a little Bessie. Establishing a new quality and complexity of recorded women's blues. And the occurrence of Janie's own recording must certainly be considered in this vibrant and pivotal cultural context. Still more, Janie Hayward is relevant, it would seem, to any discussion of sound and racial and gender caricature because of the consequential network of performances in which her work is situated. Indeed, which she seemingly helped to ignite. A master impersonator, wildly popular in her hometown, she was celebrated for what critics refer to as the inimitably natural manner with which she, quote unquote, imitated the Southern darky, drawing crowds to her gigs and garnering devoted readers who followed her pastoral tales in print. She did all of this while mothering and mentoring a son who saw fit to follow her into the family biz. The younger Hayward's respective star turn, one that eclipsed his mama's celebrity, was rooted in the intimacies of what his mother taught him, what he had to have overheard and listened out for in the Hayward family home as she perhaps rehearsed her sets, practiced the grotesqueries and absurdities of caricature and butchered Black speech, experimenting with dialectical neologisms as they rolled off her tongue and as they spilled onto the page, as they may have taken shape in front of the microphone at Victor. This woman's work became the scaffolding for a stratospherically successful career in DuBose Hayward's own right, trafficking and a dense tangle of mythologies attached to Blackness, which he would spin into fame that far exceeded his mother's. Junior DuBose matters in the story that I'm trying to tell today, precisely because of his own coming of age in a Charleston that would see one of the earliest racial conflagrations in 1919. He would have been 34 at the time of the riot and navigating his own ascent from collecting burial insurance payments in Black neighborhoods to working as a cotton checker on the Charleston docks to serving as an active member of that city's aspirational Southern Renaissance Poetry Society and the all-white local Negro Spiritual Society to eventually authoring the 1925 novel Porgy, which led to the collaboration with the Gershwins, which made him rich. But he shared with his mother and the majority of his fellow white Charleston brethren a deep and abiding resentment towards Black social and cultural autonomy and self-making, masked as a familiar desire for simpler times. Like his mama, and as historian Ellen Noonan makes clear in her marvelous and exhaustive study of Porgy and Bess in relation to Charleston, quote unquote, Hayward's authentic South was unhurried, earthy, and perfectly symbolized by its resilient and forgiving Black workers. His poetic anti-modernism, she argues, had a nonfiction counterpart in the 1930 manifesto, I'll Take My Stand, a collection of essays featuring Southern writers who dubbed themselves agrarian, who argued that industrial development fostered a culture of consumption that undermined small town rural Southern values. A self-proclaimed Southern intellectual to the bone, DuBose Hayward eventually followed his mama Janie into the business of Black sound. Both were fascinated by and sought to ventriloquize Black womanhood, from those nameless Sea Island seafood peddlers to the mythical drug-addicted wayward heroine at the center of an opera that popular culture worldwide just can't seem to quit. In my mind, the Haywards, both mother and son, were at the forefront of a battle over Black women artists' vocality, their sonic ontology, their interpretive radicalism, their aesthetic will to survive. It should be emphasized that they, of course, were not alone. As blues music scholars such as Elijah Wald points out, and as I've discussed elsewhere, the early blues, the pre-war and World War I recorded vocal blues was nothing but ersatz Black sound made by white artists such as Marian Harris, who audaciously dubbed herself the queen of the blues and everybody's red hot mama, Ukrainian born extraordinaire Sophie Tucker. In that fevered dash across the 1910s with the evolution of the phonograph and the expansion of an industry producing discs tailored to the taste of ethnic communities, Italians, Poles, and speakers of Spanish and Yiddish, there was a whole lot of blackened noise made not by Black people and with no Black listening publics in mind. In this context, then, we might think back to that parade as the pause button, the temporary cessation to all that noise accompanying the birth of a nation. Hear us in our silence, their actions cried out. Hear us controlling how, when, and whether we sound at all in the public sphere. It was a halt for just a moment before the world would catch on fire all over again. What we might ask is where Janie and DuBose on the night of May 10th, 1919 in Charleston, South Carolina, where were they? How did they feel about the pure barbarism and racially weaponized lawlessness that unfolded in the city from early in the evening that night on through until the early hours of Sunday morning, May 11th? Though for sure they weren't mixing it up out in the streets with the young white sailors roaming Charleston in search of Black blood, smashing Black property, and injuring, maiming, and murdering Black folks who were part of that city's colored population of somewhere between 48 and 52%, they most certainly shared the sentiments of one of the riot's key instigators, 19-year-old local white businessman Alexander Lano. As historian David Krugler makes clear, it was Lano who testified during court proceedings following the Navy Yard disaster, the initial focal point of conflict that night. He had always thought that quote unquote Black Charlestonians knew their place, but by May 1919, they had become troublesome and boisterous, he claimed. At times he complained, whites have to get off the sidewalk because Blacks no longer stepped aside for them, end quote. In the wake of the war effort, Charleston, like all those other cities jumping off that year, saw Black men newly returned from service and ready to serve upon the full, to seize upon the full enfranchisement entitled to them, ready to lobby for equal hiring practices at said Navy Yard, ready to hire their first Black teachers in their own segregated local schools, ready with their mates and families to take up arms by any means necessary in order to engage in what Krugler calls the wave of resistance to anti-Black collective violence engulfing the nation that year. In Charleston, it would be two teenage white sailors, Robert Morden and Roscoe Coleman, who would lead with the bloodshed, agitated by the presence of a brother on a sidewalk near the intersection of Bouffane and Archdale Streets, and his inability to yield to them in a way that might soothe their wounded white masculinity. Said brother hurled epithets at his harassers who pursued him, throwing a brick at what had by then become a growing white mob. Lana would join the mob that night, which moved through the city, storming a pool hall of Black men, resulting in the murder of an African-American named Isaac Doctor. Within an hour, says Cameron McWhorter, word of the street brawls and shooting got back to the Charleston Navy Yard, and carloads of white sailors poured into the Black district. Sailors broke into two nearby shooting galleries, stealing rifles and hundreds of rounds of ammunition. The mob swelled to 1,000 sailors plus many civilians. Rioters broke into Black homes, smashing furniture, doors, and windows, end quote. Augustus Bonaparte was pulled from his barber's chair and beaten with sticks and clubs. A Black-owned cobbler's shop was smashed. Black men were pulled from cars and trolleys and shot. A Black hack driver died from his wounds 2 weeks later. A Black bricklayer from the British West Indies was tortured with hammers, mallets, clubs, and an iron pipe. It should be noted that while the bureaucrats of Charleston moved swiftly to reestablish law and order, a white established law and order for which the city would be recognized and praised nationally, Black folks could barely tell the difference. Black citizens like William Brown and Isaac Moses had to, as Krugler argues, make split decisions about who was challenging them on the streets. The dilemma for Brown and Moses was, as he argues, of course, that the riot troops looked just like the rioters. The Charleston police, he notes, even armed the first group of provost guards with billy clubs, the weapon of choice of many rioting sailors, end quote. And what proved to be a common feature of the racial violence of 1919, he continues, Blacks now face two hostile forces, the mobs themselves and the authorities attempting to restore order, end quote. It's enough to drive a sister crazy. They were the ones who were gathering it up all for the record, storing the sonic and cultural memory of the Black masses and reassembling it in their dazzling repertoires. They were out there, in spite of the fact that history has obscured them, favoring instead the folkloric grandeur of a lone Black bluesman with a guitar slung over his back, roaming the crossroads and wrangling with the devil. This heavy romance has long obscured the sung history of the blues as a recorded event that was shaped in part by women who were watching and listening to each other and who were vocally interpreting the musical texts of Black male composers like W.C. Handy and Perry Bradford. And of course, we have the scholarship of Angela Davis, Daphne Duval Harrison, Hazel Carby, Farrah Griffin, and others to write the record new. Mamie Smith was at the forefront of that, at the very forefront of this craze, though, as I've argued elsewhere, she is oft overlooked as a pioneer of the form. Mamie Smith, that Smith, you might get her confused with Bessie or Clara, perhaps even Ma Rainey, the sisters who would easily and rapidly outshine her in the 1920s, but it is Mamie who holds the distinction of being the first Black woman vocalist to record the blues. Her Crazy Blues, a song written by Black New York songwriter Perry Bradford, set off a cultural phenomenon in 1920, creating a demand within the New York City Black community alone that resulted in a reported 75,000 copies of the record being distributed to Harlem record shops within 4 weeks of its release. It was a phenomenon that had been forecast by the silent parades and Black girls' longing that Morrison's jazz plays out for us. In the midst of that long, hot summer of 1919, when, as cultural critic David Wondrick puts it in his refreshingly rebellious study of the blues, Black America thought after the war it deserved a New Deal and white America disagreed violently. African-American vaudeville veteran turned songwriter and record producer Perry Bradford went to work on scouting for a sister who could break the blues color line and came up with Smith, a singer who was tearing up the boards in a show called Made of Harlem Uptown at the Lincoln Theater. Together, Smith and Bradford drew on Mamie's versatility as a vocalist who was equally comfortable with raggy pop and syncopep and made a record that changed the course of modern popular culture. This versatility led her to becoming what I like to think of as a curatorial bridge figure of sorts, an artist whose Crazy Blues connected Black musical theater to emerging blues cultures, Northern theater aesthetics to Southern folkloric music, white coon shatter aesthetics to Black female popular music vocalities, and an all the rage voice that could articulate tormented Black feeling in the aftermath of 1919. Her history making record forever changed the course of American popular music culture's racial politics. And it likewise stands as a recorded document of Black feminist sonic innovation, a beautiful experiment as Sadia Hartman would surely call it, a radical art of subsistence, finely interpolated by Black folks into the heart of the culture industry, a quote unquote embrace of our terribleness, as she puts it, our craziness, as I might add, a transfiguration of the given, a will to adorn, a proclivity for the Baroque and the love of too much, end quote. Hers is a record of all that and more. And no doubt, there will be those who say that Smith had little to do with breaking this portentous ground, that she was merely ventriloquizing Bradford's Black male militancy sounded out in those haunting, taboo-laden final verses, which you see here, get myself a gun and shoot myself a cop, a line worth noting that's often shortened or excised completely from future sheet music and recordings of this song. As blues historian Adam Gussow argues, such a line showcases songwriter Perry Bradford's radical articulation of the Black bad man outlaw figure willing to seize upon Black violence as a way of resisting white violence and unsettling a repressive social order in the recording studio North as well as the Jim Crow South. My contention is that there is no other way to read this line but through the prism of 1919. The year in which widespread mayhem and cops and mobs of white sailors all look the same to Black non-citizens with few safe passages available to them in the cities they called home. Part staggily bad man turned bad woman, part signifying Sophie Tucker song stylist, part Black woman performer iterating resonant Black women's blues themes on record for the first time, Smith's sonic versioning of this radicalism drew from her own vaudeville versatility to create a wicked amalgam of voices and gestures and song that effectively clapped back at Janie the darky recitalist, one-upped her in its showmanship and heterogeneous sonic reimagining of Black womanhood that pulled from the volatile history and crazy aesthetic loves and thefts all across that decade of change, mayhem, and dissent. The sound of revolution erupts from the work of an artist who claimed everything behind the microphone in spite of a Jim Crow culture that did its best to restrict her human desires and social ambitions and expected little from her. So we might listen to how Mamie's blues documents a wild experiment, one in which a palimpsest of racial and gender interpretive moves are caught on wax to great effect. Vocally, Smith's voice did indeed resonate with the swaggering lilt of Jewish vocalist Sophie Tucker's saucy phrasings and delivery, themselves reflections of Alberta Hunter's notable early blues stylings. Backed by the Jazz Hounds, a band of Black musicians led by trumpeter Johnny Dunn, Smith wailed a lament that would thematically typify the existential struggles of a musical genre on the verge of mass market popularity. I can't sleep at night, I can't eat a bite, because the man I love, he don't treat me right. Smith's Threnody is a song hardwired in big, enveloping loss as wide as the deep blue sea. It's a song that registers the plaintive wail of the standard blues heroine whose sense of abandonment leads her to the depths of suicidal despair. Sonically, it also bears the traces of Burt Williams' turn-of-the-century Black vaudeville musical poetry in songs such as the classic Nobody, which finds Williams expressing his sense of social nobodiness. Like Williams' signature song, Smith's vocals on Crazy Blues weave back and forth around wailing brass. The wind instruments, in fact, would make her number far more akin to the sound of early jazz rather than the acoustic juke joint blues born out of Southern culture. But Bradford had seemingly planned all along to spoon feed this new music to the masses. With an all Black band, he'd pulled together in a pinch. Those Jazz Hounds put a little rhythm into the proceedings while keeping it light and still driving and serving a 12 bar blues that left plenty of room in the vocal line for Mamie to work what Wondrich calls the Senegambian bends. It was, declares Wondrich in this really brilliant reading of Smith's release, Black folks' opera, the first record to present American music as a fully realized art, capable of moving emotions as well as hormones, hearts as well as feet. Like European opera, he continues, it integrates the full range of human musical expression, instrumental and vocal, rhythmic, melodic, and harmonic. Like opera, it has love, death, beauty, and pain, and yet it's not opera. There's no score. Traces, in quote unquote, traces of African-American minstrelsy and vaudeville, white coon shouter contrivances, and early jazz instrumentation thread through Crazy Blues. In its own time, it was the quintessential generic and cultural mashup track of its age. And Crazy Blues was also one hot mess of a record. From its hysterical, lovelorn heroine to its fantasy of armed resistance, to its bold indictment of police brutality, to its almost too familiar xenophobe-ready lyric, I'm gonna do like a Chinaman and get myself some hop, which traffics in crude racial caricature. Crude caricature that was troublingly and unfortunately not uncommon for Black musical theater of the period. Mamie Smith is the blues summation of all this charged history and feeling. She is paradigmatic of blues music's oft-forgotten cultural fluency, multilingualism, cross-racial imaginings, insults, and injuries. Such a performance, the first of its kind, to work its way to the center of the culture industry and thus fundamentally transform it forever, inverts dominant perceptions of mythically static Blackness and pop, that which Horton Spillers famously tells us is born out of an American grammar in which ethnicity freezes in meaning, takes on a constancy, assumes the look and the affects of the eternal. Into this brutal universe, Crazy Blues laid down for the record the sound of the Black female vocalist as social, historical, and cultural archive, a document of the noise as well as the silences, the charged interracial intimacies that stirred the pot of conflict, the wretched repression and quite often destruction of Black life that a country sought to quickly forget rather than redress. It's all in the music, she still sings out to us, crazy as that may seem. Thank you so much for your time and your patience. And it is strange to be in a virtual universe like this, but I look forward to conversations and feedback and questions.
Daphne, that's fabulous.
Thank you, sir.
I was riveted all the way through. It was just amazing. I want to say, you said your mother's online?
Yes, she is. Yes.
I want to say hi.
Well, she'll be delighted.
If this were normal times, I'd be hosting you for dinner. You'd be sitting right next to me at Benedetto's. So
virtual supper sometimes, sir.
Yeah. We'll take a rain check.
Okay.
I don't see my dear friend Glenda, and I want to ask if she would like to ask the first question. But if not, I will. Glenda, wasn't that amazing?
Oh my God, that was so great. It makes me so excited for the book, and I'm so happy it's going to be a trilogy. So, yay!
I don't know, my editor's on the call. We'll see how she feels.
Well,
Thank you. This project, again, I just want to emphasize, Porgy and Bess project completely came out of my time when I was in residence, 2010, 2011 at the Radcliffe. And Diane Paulus's collaboration with Susie Parks to reimagine Porgy and Bess, which got a lot of feedback, you know, in the app, to say the least, right? Was how I began, you know, working on this. So I feel like, you know, this community is very close to this project for me. I'm very indebted to it.
Yes, I remember I was jet lagged when we went to see it.
We went to see it, right. I saw it multiple times, but yeah.
Yeah, the first time, yeah.
Yeah, the first time, my God, wow.
Yeah. So my big question was, you know, I love that you place focus on white women in your project. And the question was, how did that come about in your research? Like, I remember your wonderful essay, What Kind of Fuckery Is This, right? Yeah.
don't say that, my mother's on the phone. It wasn't called that.
It's a quote.
It's a quote from a song.
Yes. It wasn't Daphne's actual like word. It was just quoting from But it was on Amy Winehouse, right? And a great essay. And I'm so pleased to see that you've taken that as a place to go. I mean, given our times, I was blown away by this aspect of your talk.
Yes. No, well, thank you. And you know, I came to this by just, you know, we say follow the money, follow the genealogical threads. So Dubois Hayward is just, you know, a deeply charged, problematic, white supremacist, Southern romanticist, racial romanticist figure. And I thought it was so strange that there's so little that's been written about his mother other than a passing reference to the fact that she was a dialect performer. So I wanted to know what that was. And I really did want to think about like how we understand this entire live performance culture of white women's, you know, racialized aesthetics and sound, and what that could have meant in terms of intimacies from mother to son, and especially, I mean, their narrative really is kind of, you know, a classic Margaret O'Hara. I conflated Scarlett O'Hara and Margaret Mitchell, but that's fine. You know, kind of, and Faulknerian crumbling Southern aristocracy kind of narrative. And so I was trying to think about, you know, what that meant in terms of the birth of Porgy, the novel first, which if people haven't read that, it's its own kind of, you know, deeply troubling, I would just say, you know, repulsive kind of, you know, gauzy Southern racialized nostalgia. So I was trying to dig into Hayward's development of his craft, and it brought me back to his mother. And I should just say, as probably many people on this call know, I mean, he's written many things. He wrote the screenplay to The Emperor Jones. He wrote a novel called Mamba's Daughters, which was almost turned into a stage production starring Ethel Waters. She ended up not doing it, but he is a piece of work. And so
he deserves to be a part of the narrative of Porgy and Bess in much more felt ways. So that's what I was going after.
I was intrigued by, I'm sorry, Glenda, were you finished?
I was just saying thank you. That's it.
Okay.
Thank you for the question, Mary.
I was intrigued by several things. I mean, I loved it. I was riveted from beginning to end. But how do you explain or begin to think about the relationship between the repression of Black people? Now, we have to remember that the Mississippi Plan starts in 1890. And for those who are listening who don't know what that is, you know, the 15th Amendment is ratified in 1870, and that gives all Black men the right to vote. Remember, in 1867, Black men in the South got the right to vote first, or at least in 10 of the 11 Confederate states, because of the Reconstruction Act, right?
Yeah.
But, and you can't just undo a constitutional amendment. You got to figure out, except with another constitutional amendment. Mm-hmm. So you have to figure out how to circumvent it.
Yes.
And they did that with these state constitutional convention starting Mississippi in 1890. And they were devastatingly effective, along with terrorism, of course, and rape and, you know, all kinds of violence. But these constitutions were diabolically ingenious. So all of this is happening between 1890 and 1910, right?
Yes.
So we know it's the Nader or Nadir. Yep. Black people argue about how you say that. But it's the worst moment in race relations till Donald Trump, really. But at the same time, imitations of the movements of dance and the voice of these same Black people who are being repressed is at its, I don't know statistically if it's at its height, but it would seem that way to me.
Yeah.
How do you reconcile these two things?
Yeah,
it's like a bizarre relationship between beating people up and reducing their status as a citizen, trying to make them eliminate their subjectivity and make them objects all over again.
Right.
Neo-slavery, but then valorizing their culture.
Right. Sure. I mean, we've seen this across the centuries, and thank you so much for your question. You know, we know from from the peak of Blackface minstrelsy's popularity on the stage in the 1830s to the 1860s, as our wonderful colleague Eric Lott has shown us, was a multifaceted operation in both, you know, mobilizing a kind of public sphere intimacy, self-making of whiteness, right, and also kind of representational control of Blackness. But I think very specifically in relation to the archival material that I've found with the women in particular, there's a kind of consistency around that domesticated nostalgia that's, you know, that's very much, you know, part of the Southern reconciliation, moment of the postbellum era, in which the performances become a way of trying to occupy, to re-inhabit Blackness so as to produce, you know, an ersatz form of Blackness that takes us one back in time. To, you know, a place of security, of safety, of controlled and racially dominated care. And it is still, it's always paradoxical, right? I mean, minstrelsy itself is a kind of paradoxical form, right? You're inhabiting this other thing and in order to produce your own kind of re-instantiated difference, right, from the other. But I think for these women in particular, there was a kind of a way of sort of trying to go back to their own childhood, and this was true of Janie Hayward, that was reconstructed in every sense of the word in terms of socio-material, self-worth and safety and security. These things go hand in hand, right? This is the propagandistic arm of white supremacy, which is why, you know, I use that formulation throughout this talk. I think what's kind of been interesting in working on this particular part of the project just this past year is the rise in conversations about white women's participation and collusion with, you know, their own subjugation in relation to a patriarchal system that was defined by racial dominance. So, you know, I think everything that you're saying is so important to give that historical backdrop. And I would only reemphasize that. Thank you.
Just a quick follow-up.
Yes, absolutely.
My staff will get on me for trying to dominate the conversation. I don't know why they would ever accuse me of that. But there are two different kinds of mimicry of sound.
Yes.
One is clearly parodic. Mm-hmm. I mean, and by that, I mean to connote debasing.
Yes.
Mocking. Mm-hmm. But I didn't find that sermon
right.
Mocking at all. No. I found her, you know, doing a pretty good job. Yes. I've just made a documentary series on the history of the Black Church, mm-hmm. which will be out in February. It's 4 hours. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I've been listening to Black sermons live and recorded mm-hmm. for a very long time. And I'd never heard that before. And I went like, wow, you know, she's pretty
good. Amy Winehouse.
Yeah. Now, but also remember, what year was that recording?
We think, I'm not sure about that particular track. She started her recording career in 47, so much, much later than Janie Hayward, if Janie Hayward actually recorded, which we don't know.
Oh, okay. Because at the height of, well, you can't say the height of the Nader. I'd say it's 1915, but with Birth of a Nation
yes.
being screened at the White House. Yeah. But the Azusa Street Revival, mm. Is when people start speaking in tongues. People already all long spoken tongues. And possession rituals mm-hmm. came from Africa and manifested themselves and are written about in the history of slavery. Mm-hmm. But the Azusa Street revival in the first decade of the 20th century was an interracial event. And it attracted headlines in newspapers, because you had all these white people, Asians, mm-hmm. Latinos going to LA, mm-hmm. and everybody's talking in tongues, and people like, yes. it's like chaos, you know, yes. nobody knows how to deal with it, and they're trying to shut it down, but you can't stop the Holy Spirit, right?
Right.
But there was a lot of good-natured, I'm not mm-hmm. good-natured, but faithful mimicry, you know, mm-hmm. and people were preaching like each other and speaking in tongues. So two things are happening kind of at the same time. Mm-hmm. And I find that fascinating. I mean, nobody's calling Azusa Street a racist event. You know, it's been praised for its interracial harmony and its spirituality, which challenged white supremacist notions of segregation, yes. and it got into trouble for that. Yes. So it's sort of the sound of the preacherly voice mm-hmm. Is in contrast to the sound on vaudeville stage, that's what I'm saying. So there are a lot of clashing interracial voices, positive and negative.
Absolutely, at that time. Absolutely. I guess I would just say that the problem is always racial capitalism, right? Because the recording industry is founded on these kinds of, you know, fundamental racialized socioeconomic inequities, which means that, and I was trying to really emphasize this, that Black intellectual and cultural property, you know, Black intellectual, cultural, and intellectual property circulates without African-American control of the circulation. And with Janie Hayward, we know for certain that she, you know, had a real contempt towards an anxiety about, you know, any kind of post-emancipatory Black life and equality in Charleston, which rendered her, you know, performances as being deeply charged and problematic and rooted in a kind of cultural possessiveness. With Cecile Turner, I'm not sure, need to do more research on that, you know, but I think we always want to remember, you know, and your work has taught us so much about this, that the tipped scales in terms of access to representation that charges everything, so. But thank you. Thank you for all of this. This is,
you know, I want to add one footnote, which I think you'll find interesting. Mm-hmm. Cornell, I don't know if Cornell's online, but he sent me this letter just out of the blue, a couple days ago, and it stated, because you mentioned Margaret Mitchell and Gone with the Wind, it stated June 7th, 1938, and it's written by Walter White to David Selznick. Selznick is making the film version of Gone with the Wind, and it's hilarious. I mean, in one way, it's sad in another. It's, and I'd like to read you just a brief part. We are happy to know the care which you are taking to avoid the pitfalls which are so likely in making a picture from a novel with as many false emphases as Gone with the Wind. Wherever I have gone, and the same is true of other members of our staff, we have found among both white and colored Americans a very definite apprehension as to the effect this picture will have. Frankly, I share this apprehension. Because of this, I would like to offer the suggestion that Selznick International Pictures employ in an advisory capacity a person, preferably a Negro, who is qualified to check on possible errors of fact or interpretation. I would like also to suggest that the writer of the script be Black Reconstruction by W.E.B. Du Bois. Published by Harcourt Brace.
White, the real Walter White.
Yeah, isn't that amazing? He, by the way, for those who don't know, Walter White and Du Bois hated each other, okay? So it had to take Walter White a whole lot to like recommend this recommendation. But it, then he says, should you wish it, I would be glad also to gather and send to you a few of the reviews written by competent scholars, which point out how biased Miss Mitchell's presentation of the Reconstruction era is in many instances. Ever sincerely, Walter White, who of course was hoping that Selznick would pick up the phone or the telegraph and tell Walter to get on the plane and come out there. And of course he did not. Anyway, end of footnote and well, intervention.
I mean, that's excellent. First of all, you know, thank you to my dear former colleague, Cornel West. If he's out there, hello. If he's not here, please send him my very best. And to any grad student on the call, I think there is a book to be written about kind of Black intellectual resistance to cinematic representation that begins with Birth, you know, and runs through Gone with the Wind, and includes, of course, Porgy and Bess. And there's just a troves of, you know, archival material about the resistance, you know, at that level that we just, we need to see, we need to really see and remember. So thank you for that. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Gates.
Abby Wolf, will you curate the questions, please?
I will indeed, my pleasure to. There are a lot of questions, and that was fabulous, Daphne. Thank you so much. I'm always so quick to want to get to the questions that I forget to say that, but a number of your phrases are just swirling in my head right now. And one in particular, you referred to the control of how and whether we sound, and I loved that. But anyway, that's my contribution right now. Lots of questions, and they're all different, so I can't group them. So we'll try to get through as many as we can. Here's a question from VJ Iyer, who says, "Hey Daphne, VJ Iyer here. What a phenomenal talk! Thank you for your brilliance, and I join the chorus of excitement for your books. My question is, does your work follow through on the ventriloquistic effect that this white tradition of caricature produces for the, as Gershwin mandated, all Black cast members of the opera who are paid to embody this Haywardian fantasy? How can we think through these layers of projection?"
Thank you so much. Marvelous, VJ Iyer. Thank you. And yes, this is actually something I'll be discussing on Thursday, but I've been really obsessed with this. And the trail that I kind of followed in thinking about this, and I've tried to do as much archival research as possible, but for me, it started again with that 2012 production and hearing Audra McDonald on Fresh Air talking about physically what she went through each night performing the role. And it got me to thinking about the ways that, the talk on Thursday, but the different culture workers in Porgy and Bess, and this has always been true in the Blackface terrain, but are having a kind of critical struggle, you know, and conversation with the strategies of sonic characterization that Gershwin and Hayward, who wrote lyrics Summertime and some of the other pieces in Porgy and Bess, of course, but that they had scripted and composed. And that if we start to really take apart the production as kind of a terrain of struggle, as we like to say, in our scholarship, it becomes a much richer way to be able to tease out craft and to also render or to reinvest some power in Black actors themselves as being able to hold up white cultural objects as objects of inquiry. And so, yes, that's the short answer to the question. It's very much a part of this project. Thank you, Vijay.
Great, and we'll look forward to hearing more about that on Thursday. A question just came in from Stephen Greenblatt, which connects to what you were just saying and also harks back to Skip's question. He's wondering, is the music of Porgy and Bess an instance for you of white supremacist quasi-parodic suppression of Black music, or is it an ambivalent, loving commercial appropriation, or do they amount to the same thing?
Yes. Well, first of all, and he may not remember this, but Stephen Greenblatt was my undergrad professor at UC Berkeley. I sat at the foot of the stage for English 117 for the Shakespeare survey next to Gina Dent, drinking up all the lectures. So I'm very moved that he's here. It's all of the above is the short answer to that question. There's been some beautiful new work done on Blackness in opera by a number of different folks, but there was also a collection a few years ago now, called Blackness in Opera, in which the music historian Gwen Cooner Brown actually, you know, did some archival work to really trace the collaborative intimacies, so to speak, I'm using that word, between Gershwin and the cast. And it is a really rich history, especially with regards to the first actor to inhabit the role of Bess, that she actually played a real central role in the development of not just the role, but different aspects of the music. You know, I think because especially because of Hayward, but also because of Gershwin and his complicated ties to Blackface, not only by way of his composition of Swanee for Al Jolson, but we have a brilliant graduate student here at Yale, Allison Chu in music, who's worked on Blue Monday, which is one of Gershwin's early 1920s productions, which has a little bit of it's a little bit of a blueprint to Porgy and Bess. There are some overlaps. You can see the ways that the long tail of Blackface and the violence of Blackface, which harkens back to Professor Gates' question as well, you know, plays itself out in terms of how the characters are cared for and how those characters manifest themselves sonically. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about that on Thursday. I don't want to like shift everything off to that, but yes to all of the above. It's not one thing or the other, which I think is part of what's been the sad battle about Porgy and Bess through the years, is we have to protect it on the one hand, people say, and so we can't have these conversations about, you know, violence as being, you know, mutually also constitutive of a different kind of, you know, affective adoration for this thing that you also revile.
Thank you. And Stephen Greenblatt wants to say, yes, of course, he remembers you very well.
You know, I mean, there's lots of
having insights here on these things. A couple of questions, I'm turning towards the politics, you know, explicitly toward the politics of this representation in a more direct way. Kim Benston, who former president of Haverford and former Du Bois Hutchins Center fellow, fellow, says, as always, Professor Brooks, your work is beyond awesome. Many thanks. Might you further riff on the relation between the blended vocal and visual distensions of minstrelized dialects, phantasmic projections, and the inflections of excess within Black blues women's performative reappropriations, experiments, transgressions? Is there a politics of excess that must be specifically performative, carrying rhythms of collective memory and shared gesture, requiring a certain cultural literacy in order to be acknowledged and activated?
Oh my God, Kim Benston, first of all, hi, and thank you for that marvelous question, which also contains an answer. I mean, yes, absolutely. And I think the excess is, you know, obviously something that I'm trying to affirm and draw out with regards to the cultural actors. I mean, it's important for both sets of actors across the color line, because it establishes, you know, a kind of emphasis on the performative subject who can control all of these different expressive modalities. And it becomes a much trickier way of thinking about racial authenticity politics. That's of course going to be important for African-American performers. It's also important for someone like Janie Hayward, whose proximity to Blackness, if you want to think about that, you know, along socialized lines and falling down the socioeconomic ladder, you know, is going to mark a kind of social precarity that she's going to want to be able to play out, I would imagine, right? And trying to think this through, through the dialect performances. That it's a really interesting kind of topic to keep pushing on, and that I should keep thinking about, because this performance is also, and this still goes back to Professor Gates's first question, all ideas go back to Professor Gates, that the need to perform this kind of a narrative is about a reclamation of a lost past. And it's a reminder of the kind of power dynamics that made it possible for her to become what she claimed to be, a specialist and an expert in Blackness in and of itself, right? You have to have been able to dominate Black folks, you know, in such a way that you had that kind of, a particular kind of proximity in order to then perform that way, which is not to say that you can't have working class white and Black folks alongside one another as well. But I do think both are claims to power, and excess can yield different forms of power in each line of performances. That's a great question. Thank you. Thank you.
But what about the flip? Mm-hmm. Power of forcing an imitation. The power of having a mode of expression, mm-hmm, that draws people to imitate. Mm-hmm. That was Black power. You know, there was the Black, sure, vernacular power, you know, and they were, sure, mesmerized by it, and either mimicked it or valorized it.
Right. You know? But it was a lack of, you know, of socioeconomic and social protection, obviously, right? It's like Zora's line, which I was taking out of context, but I think, you know, is helpful, you know, the lack of privacy for Black folks, as she talks about in Characters of Negro Expression, is the thing that we have to remember, right? Because then we wouldn't be talking about, now I'm gonna give away this thing I was gonna say on Thursday, but Sondheim's, you know, claim that we shouldn't touch the cultural property, the intellectual property of the Gershwins, is a negation of the long historical past in which the cultural property of African Americans was always open and presumably accessible, right, to the dominant class. So, you know, we need to have those conversations.
Are you up for one or two more questions?
Sure.
Okay, good. More than one. This is one that comes in from Brittany Mache, who was also a recent fellow of ours. In a later era, protest songs become a fixture of Black protest movements, especially the civil rights era. I'm wondering how you think about the emergence of blues in this era and its galvanizing effect as a political expression. Mm-hmm. I was struck by the silence of the protest of 1917 that you opened with. How does the sonic then seep into the culture of street protest? What was the role of the blues in that diffusion, especially given the genre's association with the juke joint and pleasure?
Mm-hmm. Beautiful question. I will say as a sidebar that there are some interesting ways that we can imagine the Gershwin songbook as having been taken up as forms of protest at the dawn of the long civil rights movement's turning point, one of its major turning points in the late 50s and early 60s. So I'll talk about that on Thursday. You know, I mean, we have so much brilliant Black feminist scholarship that I was flagging, that especially thinks about the ways that blues women, and Angela Davis obviously has spoken so powerfully to this, the blues woman's repertoire, when it was in and of itself a form of protest that spoke back to the subjugation of Black women's bodies, the control of their sexuality. It operated as a kind of a lexicon of protest about Black socioeconomic life and repression. She has, you know, a collection of lyrics of Ma Rainey and Bessie Smith and Billie Holiday in particular that map this out. And so it's absolutely a long tradition. It's interesting to think about it getting taken up in the streets as a form of protest. I mean, I'm teaching my lecture course on protest music in the Black radical tradition right now. We just got to mid-century freedom songs. And those songs obviously are deeply rooted in the long spirituals tradition and being able to kind of reshape the spirituals as forms of contemporary and modern ways of speaking to sociopolitical emergency and spiritual sustenance. You know, there's a tradition within the late 1920s, especially folks like Blind Lemon Jefferson, and other folk who are writing anti-Jim Crow songs that are then taken up again by someone like Nina Simone. So I don't know if I'm a little bit all over the place trying to give a whole canonical map here, but it's just say, yes, the blues tradition absolutely lives on as a protest music tradition. And also because the blues is the DNA of modern popular music. So it lives on in all forms of pop. Thank you for the question.
I think that's great. Two more questions. And one is bringing in, it's a speculative question, which never needs to be apologized for. From Sabine Kim, who's bringing in another type of protest that's at the time. I'm curious about whether Mamie Smith's lyric, "I'm going to do like a Chinaman and get myself a hop," could be read against the grain. Is it possible to think of it in the context of the anti-Asian riots on the East Coast in the US and Canada, offering an Asian as a figure of protest or resistance? The singer suggests doing like an Asian man. Yep. I'm curious about the hop as well, if it might be a reference to dancing. Apologies for this very speculative question, she says.
Oh no, I love the question. I've wrestled with that lyric quite a bit. And even in giving the talk today, because I have an extended passage on it in the current book. And I was like, oh, I want to make sure that this is here because we're not going to leave it hanging. And, you know, I compressed a little bit of a reference to the question of whether it's about some kind of co-marginalized shared affinities that's being worked out in a really crude and deeply problematic, repulsive way, given the slur, which reinstantiates, you know, all sorts of power and bad affect, you know, or is it, you know, xenophobic and rooted in a kind of, you know, anxiety about immigrant life that African Americans absorbed through, you know, their own, encounters with other communities with immigrant communities during this time period. And I've gone back and forth on it. I've just left open the speculation, and that's why I was really excited that you framed it as a speculative comment. We don't have archivally, as far as I know, any kind of information about where Perry Bradford was going lyrically with this, and I'm always anxious about intentionality. But I did want to emphasize that, and Stephanie Batiste's work on this, on Black folks' kind of problematic relationship to American empire that you see in theater, that there are all sorts of yellow-faced performances in African-American theater at the turn of the century and in the 1910s. And so, you know, in as much as this is a really, you know, deeply troubling aesthetic within the Black culture industry of the moment, I hear that too. The last thing I'll say, hop, I'd always thought was a reference to drugs, but I'm interested in what you're suggesting about, can we think of it in relation to dance? I'm not sure.
But I'm fascinated too. Yeah.
When I really, really, question, really, I thought, really?
I thought hop is drug.
Yeah. Hop, yeah,
right. Well, that's kind of an interesting.
Yeah. Thank you for that question. Thank you so much.
And one final question, which will lead us in different ways to Thursday's lecture, comes from Jesse McCarthy, who will be introducing you on Thursday.
The great Jesse McCarthy.
So also an assistant professor in African American studies here in English. Thank you, this was amazing. I'm wondering if you think the difference between white women in racial mimicry as compared to that of white men should be understood as the specific cultural afterlife, to use Hartman's term, of the intimate domestic violence that Tivoli, A Glimpse, catalogs and Out of the House of Bondage. Are the Black Blues women saying something back to white women specifically that we haven't sufficiently attended to until now?
Thank you, Jesse McCarthy, the brilliant Jesse McCarthy, who has one of my favorite lines that's in my current book that's coming out that I've carried with me for many years, where he calls Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man a book of strategies. So Jesse is cited in my book for having said that. I can't claim that myself. It's absolutely an afterlife. And I do think that we have to kind of, Jane Brown's work, Babylon Girls, which is still such an instructive, amazing book, has really helped me to think about the kinds of ways that the carryover from domestic power and domestic interracial conflict that plays out in the long history of captivity, you know, reemerges in the socioeconomic structures of the culture industries, such that you can have Zora Neale Hurston working for Fanny Bryce, you can have Alberta Hunter working for Sophie Tucker. And, you know, Jaina does a great job of really trying to think about and to excavate archivally what those women were working through in terms of intimate cultural knowledges that were shared, that were appropriated, you know, that had, you know, some semblances of care, but also a lack of trust and you know, deep betrayal. And so it's like grad students on the line. We need another history of, and Stephanie Jones at Berkeley has done, you know, this amazing mammoth book about the violence of white mistresses. But it would be interesting to think culturally across the ages about these kinds of charged collaborations and modes of appropriation between white women and Black women that manifest itself in terms of artistic form. And yes, I do believe that the blues women are meditating on that. And I can say more about that maybe on Thursday, you know.
Yeah, I think we've become used to recently hearing about proximity, which is a word that's come up in Bryan Stevenson's usage of it, which is as a path toward empathy and understanding. Yes. And making sense of others' experiences. Mm-hmm. But this type of proximity is twisting that knife a little bit, mm-hmm. I think.
Right, like, right. And it all comes back to, again, being able to claim the importance and the significance and the legibility of Black women as culture producers, right? Mm-hmm. And what happened to what they produced. That's something that I'm deeply invested in trying to recuperate.
Thank you. Oh, sorry, Abby.
No, I was just going to turn it over to you. We don't want to let you go, but I think we're going to now.
Yeah, no, we could stay on for another hour. And thanks to Dr. Abby Wolf for curating today's event, as she will on Thursday. And thank you, Professor Brooks, since you called me Professor Gates.
Always.
For a brilliant lecture. And as I said twice, I was riveted from top to bottom, start to finish, and I can't wait for part two. And one thing I really want to thank you for, you know, we're given Zoom manuals to say that attention wanes for our students after 20 minutes. And you said, no, I'm going to do my whole lecture. And I'm so glad you did, because you disproved this claim. And you were able to make a full argument with a beginning and a middle and an end, and you lost nobody. You know, everyone was intrigued and focused. So thank you, really.
Thank you
for showing up, as our people say. You know, this is great, and I admire you. I admire your work I have for so long, and this is just one more evolution, one more step in the evolution of your work, and I'm with great admiration and gratitude. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you, Daphne.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So much.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. Bye.
Thank you, Glenda.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.